أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. آمن الرسول بما أنزل إليه من ربه والمؤمنون كل آمن بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله لا نفرق بين أحد من رسله وقالوا سمعنا وأطعنا غفرانك ربنا وإليك المصير لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها لها ما كسبت وعليها ما اكتسبت ربنا لا تؤاخذنا إن نسينا أو أخطأنا ربنا ولا تحمل علينا إصرا كما حملته على الذين من قبلنا ربنا ولا تحملنا ما لا طاقة لنا به واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين صدق الله العظيم.
السلام عليكم ladies and gentlemen, members of the press. Thank you for joining us today in this important event. Today marks an historic occasion, a visit of an icon and the daughter of an icon. Today we are proud to welcome Ms. Eliyatha Shahbaz, the esteemed daughter of the late Malcolm X. Please join me in welcoming her here in Qatar. We are opening our event by Professor Muhammad Khalifa, the Dean of Qatar Faculty of Islamic Studies and Director of Al Qaradawi Center. Please join me in welcoming him.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Wa salatu wa salam ala Sayyidina Muhammad Sayyidina al-Mursaleen. وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. On behalf of Dr. Hatem Kanchawi, the Dean of the Faculty of Islamic Studies, and also on behalf of the faculty members and the students and the administration, I would like to welcome our distinguished guest, Eliyatha Shahbaz, and I would like to thank her also for accepting the invitation of our faculty to come and speak to us. And I would like to just brief you on the Faculty of Islamic Studies. The faculty was established in 2007. We started actually with one master degree program and three students. Our faculty actually is a graduate school. And alhamdulillah, now, after 5 years, we have six master degrees programs, and we have six research centers, and over 240 graduate students. The program are as follows. Number one, we have the program of the contemporary Islamic jurisprudence, or FIQH. and a master's degree in the study of contemporary Muslim societies. The center which is inviting us for the speech of tonight, and the Al-Qaradawi Center for Islamic Innovation and Renewal, and the Master Degree Program in Islamic Economics and Finance, and we have also the program in Public Policy in Islam, and another Master Degree Program in Islamic Architecture and Urban Planning. And at the same time, in addition to the six master degrees program, the faculty has established six research centers in order to serve the academic programs and also serve the research community of Qatar Foundation and of Qatar and the Arab world at large. The centers are Al-Qaradawi Center for Islamic Innovation and Renewal, the Center for Islamic Contribution to Civilization, the Center for Islamic Economics and Finance, the Center for Islamic Architecture and Urban Planning, and also the Center for the Study of Contemporary Muslim Societies, and the Center for the Public Policy in Islam. The faculty also includes an independent research center under the title of Islamic Legislation and Ethics, under the chairman, under the presidency of Dr. Tariq Ramadan, the well-known Islamic scholar. This is the structure of our faculty in brief. And the faculty actually is trying to combine between the traditional Islamic sciences and also the modern Islamic sciences, taking care of the issues and the challenges which are facing the Muslim community in the Muslim world, and trying to find solutions for these challenges. And I hope, inshallah, that we are successful in this attempt. I would like to repeat my thanks for all of you for coming and joining us in this very great lecture, inshallah. Thank you very much.
Now I would like to invite Director of Center for the Study of Contemporary Muslim Society, Qatar Faculty of Islamic Studies, the one and only Professor Robert Crane.
Saying a few words about the vision and mission of Malcolm X and Her Highness Sheikha Musa bint Nasser, because I think they share the same vision, the same mission, and continuing the legacy of one is continuing the legacy of the other. The basic vision of Malcolm X and his daughter Ilyasa has been to universalize the vision of Islam as its most valuable contribution to the renewal of civilization. The vision of Her Highness has been to accomplish this by bringing the best of all religions and civilizations to Qatar in order to universalize it and return it to the world, which is what the Islamic civilization did 1,000 years ago. The search for knowledge gave way to the search for survival, which is the end of all civilizations. The bold mission of Malcolm X was to move Muslims in America from the self-defeating paradigms of assimilation, which means loss of your identity and suicide. And also to overcome the approach of isolation, which is also suicide, and also confrontation, which is suicide of everybody. He brought and introduced quite early in America the paradigm of integration, which means we bring the best of what we have to offer to enrich the best of what is in the country where we live. He also, his second, I think, great accomplishment, which is still ongoing and will be for probably another 100 years, is to move Americans, both from his own community and generally in America, from toleration to diversity to pluralism. I'll define what those mean. The Dean of American Scholars on Religion in America, William Hutchinson, in his book Religious Pluralism in America, published at Yale University Press a few years ago, explained that Americans have always thought that they were one phase ahead of where they actually were and are. Toleration, as he defined it, means I won't kill you yet. Diversity means you're here, damn it, and I can't do much about it. Pluralism means it means we have much to offer. We welcome you because we have so much to offer each other. Pluralism is an ongoing a trend in America. We have never gotten as far as we like to think we have. But it's the mission of Malcolm X and his daughter and his legacy to continue this process. The highest level of accomplishment of the two, Sheikh Musa and Malcolm X, and the legacies, and there's common legacy, results from the fact that the Her Highness has been working for 15 years to realize her vision. Malcolm X's daughter, Ilyasa, has been working for 30 years. So the vision is the same of the two. And the challenge is for all of us to work together over the next 15 to 30 years while we still have time to make a difference. Assalamu alaikum.
Thank you, Professor Robert. Director of Outreach and Communication for the Center for the Study of Comparative Societies. Please welcome Nancy Elbsouni.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Ladies and gentlemen, dignitaries, professors, ladies and gentlemen, dignitaries, professors, students, and esteemed guests, it is with great pleasure that I welcome you tonight to our distinguished speaker series. I feel privileged to have the honor of introducing tonight's guest speaker, Ilyasa Shabazz, to help kick off our center's speaker series. Tonight's inaugural speaker, Ms. Ilyasa Shabazz, is an author, an activist, and a motivational speaker who is dedicated to promoting justice and service to humanity. She follows in the footsteps of her iconic father, Malik Shabazz, also known as Malcolm X, and her inspiring mother, Dr. Betty Shabazz. They all have worked towards pursuing justice for all. First and foremost, I am fortunate enough to say that I know Ilyasa, and I had the opportunity to get to know who she really is. She is a good friend and a dear sister. Malcolm X is revered today as one of the most eloquent public speakers, a beacon of truth and justice, and a true Muslim American leader who has paved the way for so many Muslim Americans as well as non-Muslims alike. Before I introduce tonight's distinguished speaker, allow me to share with you a short passage from one of Malcolm X's letters that he had sent back to the US from Hajj. Never have I witnessed such sincere hospitality and overwhelming spirit of true brotherhood as is practiced by people of all colors and races here in this ancient holy land, the home of Abraham, Muhammad, and all other prophets of the Holy Scriptures. For the past week, I have been utterly speechless and spellbound by the graciousness I see displayed all around me by people of all colors. Now, if you'll allow me, I'd like to play for you a very short clip showing some of Ilyasa's past activities.
Most of us are at least partially shaped by the events of our youth. Consider the case of Ilyasa Shabazz, daughter of Betty Shabazz and Malcolm X.
My dad said education is our passport to the future.
She's the director of public affairs and special events for the city of Mount Vernon. But Ilyasa Shabazz spends much of her time now as a public speaker, often in connection with her book, Growing Up X.
I think for a lot of children, especially of color, there's nothing that really reinforces pride and their heritage. My thing is always to try and empower people.
Obviously, you're a big advocate for equality across the board. Do you want to talk a little bit just about kind of your views on that?
You know, it's just, again, important that one should not be discriminated against based on their sex, creed, or ethnic background. And I think that every child deserves an opportunity to feel good about him or herself. If we look into history, we'll see that there is contribution from each. I'm just very committed to empowering young people.
Step out the front door like a ghost into a fog where no one notices the contrast of white on white. And in between the moon and you, angels get a better view of the crumbling.
Going to see my hero, Winnie Mandela. Winnie Madikizela Mandela.
Okay.
Mandela. That's who we're going to see. And it is an absolute honor.
Beautiful! My God! That's beautiful! Whoa! Beautiful! You know, I want to tell you that. You are really my only living hero, and it's really an honor to me. I have to tell you,
a profound experience for me was reading the biography of Winnie Mandela, mind-blowing, and so it was a most endearing and heartfelt moment when Camille and I met her.
That's wonderful!
Yes, indeed. And still as beautiful as ever.
Pick up that mantle and run the final mile. So the youth have to know that any country, even rich US, without taking care of their children, there's no future. Because the future of every country is its youth. You have to invest everything in the youth of the land if you want a stable future and the future for your own children's children. And what would be the point, in any case, of leading a useless life and you know that when yours come to an end, nobody's going to continue that life. Every parent should know that children are a continuation of themselves. So what we were in life and what we are, we should instill in our children. And because they have to be told that they are a continuation of that struggle we fought everywhere in the world. Therefore, I know my children will run the last mile, and that should be the case here. Malcolm knows where he's like, but his children will run the last mile and will carry the mantle to the grave.
I'm here in Mali. I'm here with Malaria No More to help distribute 2.2 million bed nets to the millions of families who are affected by malaria. We're here to help reduce the mortality rate. Malaria is the number one killer of African children. It's a mosquito that bites mostly young children under the age of 5 and poisons their blood system. It's deadly. It's important to me because I think children all deserve an opportunity to live. They deserve an opportunity to flourish. I think people all around the world should care about children, and especially if we can prevent children from dying when it is preventable.
Challenge each of you and to encourage you and your continued participation in honor of that legacy of self-determination, self-respect, and self-reliance. If you, the student, are continuing the fight for truth and diversity and education as your predecessors, then you will not be good stewards of the human rights mission. And you will be unable to effectively empower this community to join the struggle to attain the goals of peace, equality, freedom, and justice. There can be no peace without freedom. There can be no freedom without justice. And there can be no justice without truth. And I believe the struggle for justice begins with each of us a broad-based education that teaches truth.
Okay, so without further ado, please join me in welcoming our distinguished speaker for the evening, Ms. Ilyasa Shabazz.
My premise this evening is very simple. I believe that every child should have an opportunity to feel good about him or herself. That every single child, regardless of race, creed, or gender, should feel safe and secure simply to be. To be beautiful, to be proud, to be loved. You see, I believe that no matter where we find ourselves in the world, the opportunity to be our greatest self should be limitless. Most adults, most parents, despite the miles between us, want the same for their children that your parents want for you. To be happy, to be healthy, to be educated. Freedom, so that each one of you is prepared to fully participate in the mainstream of society. However, if there exists any injustice based on race, creed, or gender, socioeconomic background that prevents one's opportunity to reach his or her highest goal, then as Muslims, As members of the human family, we must stand up to oppose it, to ensure that no child is ever left behind under any circumstance. Are you all in agreement with that?
Yes.
To His Excellency Sheikh Hamad bin Khalifa Al Thani, to Her Highness Sheikh Hamza bin Nasser Al Misneh, to the scholars, administrators, and staff of the Faculty of Islamic Studies, to all ambassadors, government officials, and dignitaries present, to my dear sister and special friend, Nancy Al-Basuni, to the Qatari community, and especially to all of the beautiful and vibrant young leaders in the audience this evening, I think that we should give you all a round of applause for coming. There is a misconception about the Middle East. There is a misconception about Qatar. There is a misconception about Muslims and Islam. There is a misconception about our young people. When people heard I was traveling here, they said, be careful. Muslims are fighting. Women are oppressed. They don't have a voice. They said young people are not being educated. But alhamdulillah, this is not the case. Qatar is led by a progressive monarch. The driving force behind building this magnificent education city is a woman. The architecture is exquisite. Educational facilities from school age to research level are housed here. Leading universities from around the world are represented here. Women occupy positions of leadership and are enrolled in educational programs in representative numbers. Men are progressive. Children are flourishing. Peace abounds. Qatar is absolutely beautiful. It is therefore your obligation to study and to document the truths of your heritage, your culture, your identity, and your religion. It is important for you to understand the importance of education. Young people, you are the leaders of tomorrow. You must be the leaders in your own lives, on your campuses, and in your communities. We must accomplish a greater understanding of Islam and of the transformational power within each of us, as exemplified by my father, Al-Hajj Malik Shabazz, brother Malcolm X. My father said, when you educate a man, you teach a community. When you educate a woman, you raise a nation. And I think we should give all of the women in here a round of applause for that. And in the words of Sheikh Amoza, that which is unfolding in the classrooms deserves all the support we are capable of offering. Our students and teachers are giving us something invaluable in return, the brightest possible future. Progressive leaders understand the power of education. I'm honored and humbled to be with you this evening as a daughter of Malik Shabazz Malcolm X to discuss the transformative power of education, continuing the legacy of my father. As a Muslim, Malcolm X deferred his individual freedom and personal gain to encourage the achievement of one's fullest self, of one's fullest potential for the benefit of humanity, asking nothing for return in himself. I founded Malcolm X Enterprises to continue his emphasis on educational achievement, to accurately document his life and works, and to expand my activism in the cause of human rights. Our initiatives celebrate the oneness of humanity, denounce war and injustice as indefensible devastations of human, economic, and environmental resources, and seize opportunities to promote equality and peace. Current projects include the Malcolm X documentary, which will highlight the global scope of my father's contribution and effect. It will be the first ever family-endorsed documentary, with observations by scholars, allies, those directly influenced by my father, to present the domestic and international impact of Malcolm X's political, economic, and cultural agendas. One of my favorite speeches of my father's is his debate at Oxford University, because we get to see Malcolm for who he is. He was not directly addressing terror and injustice, but rather he was engaged in dialogue about our responsibilities to teach others as human beings. Using an old African proverb to teach the oneness of humanity, he said, "It takes a village to raise a child." And we must all play a role in that village. He said, "I'm for truth, no matter who tells it. I'm for justice, no matter who it is for or against. I'm a human being, first and foremost, and as such, I'm for whomever and whatever benefits humanity as a whole." He went on to quote William Shakespeare's Hamlet, which was one of my favorites in school. "To be or not to be, that is the question. Whether it is nobler in the mind to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune or to take arms against a sea of troubles and by opposing end them." And of course, when I was in school, I couldn't understand why our professor insisted that we not only like this quote, but that we memorized it. I didn't understand, but as you get older and you understand the world that, in which we live, you give much respect to the elders who are teaching us. You see, it doesn't matter that we are Muslim. It doesn't matter our ethnicity or gender, whether African, Asian, Arab, European, male, female, no matter where we find ourselves in the world, we must take responsibility for solving our society's problems. If leadership is moving too slowly or not at all, then we must become the change that we seek. We must look in the mirror and understand that we are responsible for moving our families and communities forwards. We are our brothers and sisters' keeper. And if we are educated and we understand history, we will know that we cannot expect someone else to do our jobs for us. That we must do it ourselves, that we must equip ourselves to be the leaders in our classrooms, to be the leaders on our campuses, to be the leaders in our communities, to be the leaders of our own lives. What my father represents to many is the transformative power of self. My parents lived in a world where society dictated whom they would be, placing man-made obstacles in their paths, making their life challenges more difficult. However, they assumed leadership roles and opposed them. In spite of the many obstacles and challenges, Malik Shabazz Malcolm X and his wife, Haja Betty Shabazz, Dr. Shabazz, opposed them. They took a stance and sought to provide a safer place for their children and to leave a better world for all of humanity. You see, Malcolm X was a man of great compassion. He was a man of impeccable integrity. He envisioned the world renewed by peace, justice, and equality. He championed egalitarianism, regardless of religion, ethnicity, or gender. He selflessly circled the globe to advocate the oneness of humanity. And many people don't understand that he was only in his 20s, and during that time, there weren't many people traveling so much from the US, especially young African-American men. He sacrificed his individual freedom and personal gain to advance the cause of human rights. I was just a little girl, not quite 3 years old, when my father was politically assassinated in the presence of his family, when he was martyred. And so my memories of him, as I recount in my book, Growing Up X, are images of moments spent with him. Like most children, I was in love with my father. He was daddy, and our house came alive in a very special way when he came home. He was tall, a little over 6'4". And he had big, pearly white teeth that would pierce through an enormously beautiful smile. When you're a little girl and you see these teeth, you know, they look like big diamonds. I remember his voice with such authority as he'd call my name, Ilyasa. And my mother told me back then, I listened to no one. But when Daddy called, I stopped my tracks to give my attention to him. My mother often spoke of my father in our special ritual. In the evenings, I'd wait for him at the front door. He'd come in, wash his hands, get situated, pick me up, and hold me in one arm while holding a plate of homemade cookies my mother would make and a newspaper in another. We'd go into the den to watch the evening news. He'd also be reading so many papers, and we would share these cookies. So after my father was killed, and my family was staying at the home of Sidney Poitier, I continued the ritual of waiting for Daddy. I'd sit at the front door and look out the window for my father, but I'd never see him. And my mother couldn't explain death to a toddler, so she began to take a cookie and break it in half and leave it for me on a plate at the front door. I'd get that cookie, but Daddy never came home. And so cookies came to remind me of the precious times I spent with my father. When my mother first shared this story at a congressional breakfast in Washington, D.C., my girlfriends were very surprised, because those who knew me would give me cookies or cookie jars for holiday gifts. They knew I had this distinct connection with cookies, and my mother explained why. But as you grow older, sisters, you come to the realization that a woman's hips can no longer tolerate cookies. So look, if you like cookies, you eat them while you're young. Because as you get older, you have to either expand with these cookies or not. And so you look for other vices, like fruit, exercise, good books, prayer, and therapy. Now, I recently read a poll conducted on adolescents who were asked what they would like to be when they grow up. Their answer was quite simple, and I quote, rich. Not rich in service, not rich in helping anyone, but just rich. And it touched me. What happened? What happened to our humanity? To our compassion? Because this sort of focus on a material gain only should be unacceptable, ladies and gentlemen. You are worth much more than that. People often ask me what it's like to be the daughter of Malcolm X and Dr. Betty Shabazz. I was raised very proud to be of African ancestry, very proud to be a Muslim, and very proud to be a woman. I recall watching my mother work in the cause of human rights and women's rights in particular. I remember her participating in the International Women's Conference that was held in Beijing, China, shortly before she passed away. Writing my book, Growing Up X, afforded me an opportunity to reflect on her life as a source of inspiration and empowerment. My mother was just a young woman in her 20s, just a few years older than many students here when she witnessed the political assassination of her husband. 1 week prior, I don't know if you know Valentine's Day, but in the States we celebrate love, and it's called Valentine's Day on February 14th. 1 week prior, on Valentine's Day, a Molotov cocktail was thrown into the nursery of her home, where my sisters and I slept as babies. When my father was gunned down, my mother was left traumatized, frightened, and alone. She was a young woman with 4 babies and pregnant with my youngest twin sisters. So she had 6 babies in total. And I've often asked myself, with 6 babies, widowed and the wife of Malcolm X, the wife of a young man who challenged a government that had been historically unjust to its own people, how was this young woman Betty Shabazz, able to overcome such a loss and so many obstacles and still raise six daughters and still dedicate her life to giving back to others and still earn a PhD? How? She never accepted no or I can't as an answer. My mother survived because of her faith in Allah and because she knew the importance of self-respect, self-esteem, and the understanding of history to empower her. Education reinforced her capabilities. And she raised six girls in Islam with the knowledge of history as a means to develop a healthy identity, self-respect, and with an understanding of an obligation to others, that we are our brothers and sisters' keeper. My father, Malik Shabazz, Malcolm X, was only in his 20s when he burst onto the scene of the human rights struggle. He too was only a few years older than many students, than many of you here, because many of you look like you're about 15. He campaigned for every breathing human being. He campaigned against institutional racism. And in the 12 short years immediately preceding his martyrdom, Alhaj Malik Shabazz rose to the defense of African Americans brutalized by discrimination. He challenged white supremacy and racial injustice. He redefined the American civil rights movement to include a human rights agenda. And he worked tirelessly to unite Africa and the diaspora towards a singular international struggle for freedom and independence. As a young Muslim African American man, Malcolm X accepted the mantle of leadership in the human rights struggle because he understood the oneness of humanity, that we are all brothers and sisters in the family of God. He awakened us with information of that heritage, with information to provide us with a healthy identity as we navigated through the challenges of defining ourselves. Hence, a blueprint for social justice, a model for Muslims battling Islamophobia, a model for anyone battling any form of injustice. As Muslims, we must take responsibility to educate the world about the truths of Islam, that it is a religion of peace. And so we must ask ourselves, what are we doing as stewards of Islam? What are we doing with the privileges and resources Allah has bestowed upon us? Are we ensuring that impoverished Muslims around the world, despite their ethnicity, are fed, housed, and educated? Are we taking individual responsibility for improving the image of our religion? I encourage each of you to produce and support educational programs. Young men and women, my young brothers and sisters, you must prepare yourselves to fulfill your lives purpose. Think creatively about the ways to fulfill your charity. As Muslims, we can ensure that the proper image of Islam is projected around the world. If we live our truths and strive to fulfill our lifelong obligation to become better people. As young men and women, if your goal is to be a doctor, You should not study medicine just for social status, rather become a doctor to ensure that disadvantaged people will have adequate medical attention. If your goal is to be an attorney, you should not study law just to buy a bigger home, rather become a lawyer so that you can fight all forms of injustice. If your goal is to become a teacher or professor, please do not aspire for such a profession simply for social status. Rather, become an educator so that you can stand with Sheikha Moza to build new education cities wherever they are needed. and fulfill a mission of educational opportunities for everyone, including women and girls. And if you are committed, then whether you're a lawyer, doctor, artist, musician, politician, or professor, your purpose and your service will be to improve upon and give back to society. We must ensure that when history is taught, it includes the full contribution of all with integrity and honesty. Education transforms our understanding. With accurate information, we realize that we cannot suppress another without subjugating ourselves, that we cannot come to the aid of another without helping ourselves. And this evening, as we pay tribute to a part of ourselves and a part of our history, may each one of us emulate the wisdom, courage, and purpose of our ancestors to produce the best in ourselves that Allah intended. And in that manner, our lives will not be in vain and our blessings will reign on forever, inshallah. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. I'm sure the audience would agree with me that it's been an honor to have this privilege of your coming and speaking with us today about this very important topic. And on behalf of the Qatar Faculty of Islamic Studies and the Center for the Study of Contemporary Muslim Societies, we want to thank you from the bottom of our hearts for making this long, what was it, 14 to 18 hour trip?
2 days.
2 day trip from the US. And joining us today. Right now we're going to open up the floor for 5 minutes worth of questions pertaining to today's talk. So we'll entertain, I guess, the first three questions here. Anybody? Wow. Everybody's tired, huh? Do you have? Yes.
I guess I want to ask you about racial inequality in the U.S., if that's okay. I witnessed the Obama, 2008, when I was in the U.S. in 2008, and I saw when Obama won the election, I was there for school, and I saw my African-American friends or crying your eyes out. And I thought to myself, my God, you know, Malcolm X and Martin Luther King dream came true finally. And I was wondering if do you see that racism in the US is no longer there? Do you see Islamophobia as diminishing in a way? I was wondering if that's the case, because to be honest with you, I still do think that racism still exists and Islamophobia still exists, but I guess with less than it was before in the 60s and before the interrogation and things of that kind.
Okay, I think that racism, of course it still exists. Islamophobia, of course it still exists. It says that our young people have a lot of work to do, that they are very much needed to change all of this. I think, you know, it was wonderful, it's a historic moment to see President Obama elected and to be reelected. And what it does is it lets young men of color know that they can aspire to be not only the president of the United States, but they can aspire to be the presidents of their classes, the presidents of different organizations. So I think it was definitely something really great, but racism exists, injustice exists. And it is our responsibility as the parents, as the adults, to teach our children better, to make sure that they understand that there is no difference in us, that we are all children of Allah, and that we all deserve the same opportunity, despite our ethnicity, despite our gender, man, woman, despite our religions.
Okay. Do you have another question?
Yes, good evening everyone. My name is Alfreda Haggard, and I don't have a question, but I just wanted to tell you that it's a joy to be here, and we'd love to have you over at the Community College of Qatar. Our school is the first junior college in the region, and we're very proud of it. As you can tell, a lot of my faculty and staff are here in support of the event here, and we just love to have you come and talk to our young Qatari young ladies and our young men. And so if we could arrange that, that would just put joy in our hearts.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that.
I think we have.
Salaamu alaikum. I have just a small question for you. Thanks for the speech. I have the impression that at the time of your father, rahimahullah, and Muhammad Alija and the black Muslims, nowadays I have the feeling that there is no one representing Islam like before. How can you explain that? In the U.S., I'm talking about.
Well, again, it's important for us to teach our children so that we do have those leaders that we seek. And, you know, number one, so that you have to make sure that your children and that your younger brothers and sisters, that they are going to be those leaders that you are looking for.
A researcher at the Faculty of Islamic Studies as well. My name is Ruki Amon. And again, thank you so much for coming here. I'm from America as well. So it's sort of ironic that, you know, we find you here. My husband and I are from Atlanta, Georgia.
Please raise your voice.
I'm sorry. My husband and I are from Atlanta, Georgia. And we enrolled our children in the Muhammad schools, which is something that came out of the Deputy Muhammad movement. And I just wanted, for us here at the Faculty of Islamic Studies, one of the things that we're engaged in doing is articulating what sort of product we want from our educational system. And we're in the position of identifying what makes us Muslim. And when talking about the legacy of education, I was wondering if you could shed a little bit of light on what specific educational principles were articulated with the W.D. Muhammad movement, and how that addressed some of the gaps in the education that men such as your father identified during that time.
I wasn't with that movement. I wasn't with W.D. Muhammad, you know, so I'm not sure of his educational curriculum. But I know that the curriculum that my parents encouraged was to understand my history, to understand where I was from, in spite of the institutional racism. So that, you know, again, I was raised proud to be a woman, an African-American of the African diaspora, and proud to be a Muslim, in spite of all of the images and institutionalized images and things that said that all of those things were bad, that I still am very proud of who I am. I'm very strong about who I am. You know, so I think that those things are important, that we have to teach our children at home before anything else, that we have to be great parents, that we have to take that responsibility very seriously.
Okay. Should we do one last question?
Hello.
Okay.
Salaam alaikum, good evening. My name is Nina Hale. I'm a French researcher. Students, and my question is, modernity has pushed us in preserving heritage, culture, identity, and religion, as you say today. Yeah, okay. And I completely agree with you. Last month, we had an issue in the French school in Qatar here, where a young student has been obliged to leave the class because she was wearing hijab. education, as you said, as teaching to be a community, yeah? What do you think your dad would be doing in that case? And what is our responsibility to be in this issue?
Well, you know, it's very hard for me to always project what my father would be doing. I feel if my father lived that a lot of these injustices that are occurring would no longer occur, because I think that he was really doing such a great job in addressing these issues and making us accountable as human beings, first and foremost. And I want to thank you very much for your question. I forgot that one question.
Yes,
it's
okay.
Thank you for an absolutely terrific presentation. I find it fascinating that your mom had an advanced degree. She had six daughters. You're obviously extraordinarily educated. And we're seeing a very interesting gender bias occur in the United States. And that is the successes in education are being achieved amongst women. And men are falling behind. I'd be interested in your perspectives on that.
You know, my mind is racing. And the answer depends, I think, on where you are. Because you can... And so I think that I should pull back. But excellent question. And it is true that women are being educated more and more. And it looks like my father, you know, saying... When you educate a man, you raise a community, and when you educate a woman, you raise a nation. So we have to do our, we just have to assume our responsibilities as human beings.
I think I have to say the same is true in the Middle East as well. I think we see a lot more women, not just getting formal education, but advanced education. So I think there's a big trend all over the world. And,
it's a good one.
A very good one, yes.
Good evening. My name is Esker Copeland. I also am from Atlanta, Georgia, as one of the previous questioners was. As a person who's dedicated my life to helping young people achieve their full potential, so I work here with Qatar Foundation, with their Reach Out to Asia program. You mentioned purpose and giving young people a sense of purpose. I've worked in the United States, I've worked in Africa, I've worked in Asia, I work now here in the Middle East. It is very difficult, from my perspective, to get young people to have this strong sense of purpose. And you talked about this. I wonder, from your perspective, what were some of the factors that motivated your father, from your perspective, to have such a strong sense of purpose? And, as an educator, what can I do, possibly, to help more young people get, you know, gain that sense of purpose that you talked about?
The purpose is the truth in education. I think it's important for young people, especially young children of color, to understand the richness of their heritage. People from this side of the world to understand the richness of their heritage, the truth of their heritage, the truth of history. I think it's extremely important. I have a wake-up tour, and I go around, sometimes I pay for bringing children to auditoriums this size and larger, from group homes, from lockup facilities, on regular college campuses, to let them see adults who had similar challenges in their lives as children, and because of those challenges, they were able to, that gave them character and strength. Most of the people on our panels are celebrities, so these young people are excited about them, but to find that they endured some similar challenge that a lot of our young people are facing, but on top of that, with historians, you know, who tell them the truth of history, which makes them feel good about themselves, they find that there's a part of history that they can identify, and so seeing these ancestors accomplish great things, that they can accomplish great things, understanding that these people had purpose in their lives,
They, in turn, have purpose in their own lives, having compassion for their brothers and sisters, rather, you know, pulling yourself up by your own individual bootstrap doesn't work. So it's giving them a sense of who they are, genuinely caring about them, and, you know, and it works. It works. And I believe that my father, you know, my father was really the same. He was a very compassionate person. He had integrity. He did not compromise anything for the sake of personal gain. You know, he was, as he, you know, I said, for truth, no matter who tells it, for justice, no matter who it's for or against. And his purpose, he served God. He served Allah. And I think great things happen when you are true to yourself.
Okay, so we're going to stop here only because Eliasa had a very long trip, so we're going to give her a break. And plus because there's some really delicious refreshments outside, so,
And I'd just like to thank Nancy for inviting me, because, you know, again, there are many people who always say, oh, don't go, this is not my first time here, but even, you know, for whatever reasons, and Nancy was extremely insistent, and so, Nancy, I came because she was extremely insistent.
I don't take no for an answer. Thank you again so much for joining us this evening. This has been an amazing event, so I guess I didn't lie when I said you guys are in for a treat. And again, please join us for some delicious refreshments, and thank you.